Hi friends, in our last session, we have seen a design criteria for a machine tool structure, that is influence of a material. Even we have seen bars subjected to different loading conditions, that is tension, torsion and bending. In today's session, we are going to study static stiffness and dynamic stiffness. This is Prashant Kagdi and I welcome you all for lecture series of machine tool design. Now let's begin. So first, static stiffness. Now, as the name itself suggests, that what is static stiffness? So stiffness is basically resistance to deformation, and static stiffness is a resistance to deformation under static loading. Static loading, which we have discussed already, that is a loading conditions when a machine is not under operation. It's not in operation. That is by the weight of different elements. For example, weight of tailstock, weight of carriage on a guide wheels, and cutting forces. So all this can affect, or we can say lead to, a bending or torsional loads, right? So this can be avoided if a machine tool or a structure has a high static stiffness. Okay, so we are going to study over here the behavior of an individual element under static loading condition, and this can be examined by using a force displacement relationship. So in a diagram you can see three different cases. First case is for a non-linear, second case is a linear in a particular range, and third is totally linear. This relationship in general will be non-linear as shown in figure A. Okay, so the quantity which is called dp by dy, that is force upon y's displacement over here, is equal to 10 alpha, which is basically equals to representing a stiffness, right? That is stiffness, we know it's a ratio of load upon displacement. So dp is a change in force, or we can say load upon displacement is a y. Okay, now if you see this diagram, so from this diagram we can say that this is a non-linear curve, right? Now let us consider at any point that is force p1, the corresponding displacement, corresponding value would be somewhat, let's say y1, right? And a corresponding stiffness would be how much? So kp1, that is a stiffness corresponding to force p1. Now if we see carefully, then we know that it is making an angle alpha with the horizontal axis. So what would be 10 alpha? So 10 alpha would be opposite upon adjacent. So opposite would be this vertical value. So this value is how much? So we would say this is a change in force, that is represented by dp, right? And upon horizontal, upon adjacent value. So adjacent is what? So we would say this value is adjacent value. So this is what? So it is dy. So we can even say that 10 alpha is equal to dp by dy, which is known as a static stiffness of element at force p1. Now it may be noted that a displacement y is measured in the same direction in which force p is applied. If the relationship p is equal to f of y is linear, that is our second case, we are going to consider a linear relationship between force and displacement. That is, a force applied with respect to that, the displacement takes place in a linear form. Okay. So in that case, there would be a range of force between, that is P1 and P2. Okay, so you can see over here it is plotted force P1 and force P2. Then the stiffness in this range is considered to be constant. Okay, so over here you can see it is shown by a straight line. Okay, in a range between force P1 and force P2, the line is straight, representing a linear line. Okay, in this range. Now how we can find this stiffness in this range? So it is denoted by K P1 minus P2. Okay, P1 minus P2, which should be equal to what? The load upon displacement. So load is how much? So we would say delta P, that would be what? So P2 minus P1 is delta P upon delta Y. So it is what? So Y2 minus Y1, right? So this delta P and delta Y are obtained in a specific range wherever the curve form is in a linear form between the two particular forces. Okay, that is force P1 and force P2. Okay, or we can say load P1 or load P2. So this is a relationship for a linear in a particular range. Now if a relationship of P equals to F of Y is linear throughout, which means in a whole range of variation of forces it is linear, then what will be the formula to determine stiffness, shown over here by this line, which is representation of a linear throughout the entire range. So stiffness would be K is equal to P by Y directly. Okay, so this is our formula for our linear case in our entire range. This is a formula of a stiffness for a linear case in a particular range. And this is a formula of our stiffness, that is dp by dy equals to 10 alpha, is a formula for our non-linear case. Okay, that is case A. Now the quantity which is inverse of stiffness is called compliance. Okay, remember, it is denoted by capital C. The reciprocal or inverse of stiffness is called compliance, and it is employed for analyzing the behavior of a structure under static loading condition. Okay, now let's proceed further. Now, as already stated, a machine tool consists of a number of elements, right? We know that tail stroke, head stroke, right? Spindle, okay, tool post. So all these elements experiences deformation during operation of a machine tool, and therefore can be looked upon as an elastic body, which means elastic body resembles to a spring. Okay, so we are going to consider the spring system with a certain stiffness, let's say a spring constant, K. Stiffness is represented by K. The machine tool is thus reduced to a system of springs which are joined either in a series connection or in a parallel connection. Some important conclusions about a cumulative stiffness of a machine tool system may be drawn from a study of a simple spring system connected in series and parallel connections. So basic connection, series and parallel connections, you have studied in your subject dynamics of machinery in a vibration topic, right? In which you have seen that a series connection of a spring and a parallel connection of a spring in which a load is applied, right? Damping, dampers and spring arrangements are used, right? In our vibration system. So what would be in a series connection? So for understanding a series connection, you have to refer a diagram which I have shown on in a next slide. So you can see this is the arrangement, series connection arrangement. Okay, now this is a fixed support over here. You can see I have shown three springs. Each spring has a different stiffness. Let's say first spring has a stiffness K1, second spring has a stiffness K2, third one has a stiffness K3, and are arranged in series, which means the load acting on all the three springs is same. That is how much? So that is capital P. Okay, so the P is a load which is acting. Now each of these spring will have a different deflections, right? Spring 1 would have a deflection, let's say delta 1, spring 2 would have a deflection delta 2, spring 3 has a deflection delta 3. Now this spring is a representation of this gearbox arrangement, which means over here you can see this is an electric motor which is transmitting a power to our final output shaft, which is connected to our spindle, machine tool spindle, through the entire stage. So you have studied in our multi-speed design of multi-speed gearbox, that is chapter number 2. In which this represents a stage 1, this represents second stage, and this represents third stage, which means a three stage arrangement has been shown for a power transmitting from an electric motor to a machine tool spindle, and this is a representation of this three of this gearbox arrangement. Okay, so this is a spring representation. So let us determine the equations for a series connection. So as I have told that set of spring having a stiffness K1, K2 and K3 joining a series connection. So since the force is remaining constant but a deflection would be different, so the total deflection would be how much? So it would be the summation of deflections of individual spring. So over here you can see deflection is represented by Y. Okay, so total deflection is capital Y, which is equal to Y1 plus Y2 plus Y3. Now what is the formula to find out deflection? So we know that is a relation is stiffness is equal to load upon displacement, right? So from that we can say that displacement would be equal to load upon stiffness. So for spring 1, how much would be the displacement? So it would be P upon K1, since P is remaining constant, that is same. Okay, P upon K1, since we know that force is same for our series connection. Similarly, plus P upon K2 plus P upon K3. So from this equation, can I say that Y will be equal to how much? So it would be P upon K, where P is a constant force and K is our total spring stiffness, right, for an entire system. Okay, so if a resultant stiffness of a system of a spring is denoted by capital K, so this equation can be written as P upon capital K is equal to P upon K1 plus P upon K2 plus P upon K3. So finally, since P is constant, we can cancel out. So final equation will become 1 upon K is equal to 1 upon K1 plus 1 upon K2 plus 1 upon K3. Now, since we know that compliance is inverse of stiffness and it is an ability to determine the behavior of a structure, so can I say that 1 upon K is a compliance denoted by capital C, right? So in form of compliance, we can write this equation as C is equal to C1 plus C2 plus C3. Now, if a machine tool element are used for transmission, then the resultant stiffness of a system of a spring is obtained by adding reduced stiffnesses. Let us consider a case that is a shaft which transmits a rotation from a motor to the output shaft, which I have shown, right? So we are going to see that figure. Now let the torsional compliances of the each shaft is C1, C2, C3 and C4. That is, torsional compliances are C1, C2, C3 and C4. And the transmission ratio, that is, we know transmission range ratio, which we have studied in our multi-speed gearbox. So let's say it is denoted by I12, I23, I34. So here, torsional compliance represents the angle of twist between the shaft and if the loaded by unit torque, and I12, I23 and I34. So I12 represents the transmission range for first stage, I23 represents transmission range for second stage, I34 represents transmission ratio, that is transmission range ratio for our third stage. So the resultant compliance of a system can be determined by using our previous equation, right? That is, C is equal to C1 plus C2 plus C3. But over here, we are going to consider a transmission range ratio. So with respect to that, the equation will become C is equal to, now for the first shaft, it is represented by C1. So the compliance is for this shaft is C1. Now, since we know the transmission range ratio, so we can say that it would be C1 into I12 square into I23 square into I34 square. Similarly, plus we need to add for shaft 2. So shaft 2 compliance is, torsional compliance is C2. So we can say C2 into I23 square into I34 square, plus for shaft 3 is C3. So C3 into I34 square, and plus for shaft 4 is C4. Now over here, it would be not multiplied by transmission range ratio. So it is very obvious that in summation, this C4 is going to contribute much higher to the total compliances, right? So if higher is a compliance, which means what? Lower will be the stiffness, since it is a reciprocal of a stiffness. And if it is stiffness is lower, which means resistance to deformation will be lower. So what we need to do? So in this case, we need to increase the dimension of our shaft 4. Okay, so final shaft dimension has to be increased. Why? Because it has high compliance. So over here, you can see it is written that if it is assumed that a transmission range ratio are less than 1, that is, the speed is being reduced in transmitting rotation to each succeeding shaft, it is the evident from this equation that if all the shafts are assumed to have identical compliance, the contribution of shaft 4 to the overall compliance is maximum, while the contribution of shaft 3, 2 and 1 will go on decreasing in that order because of transmission range ratio. Therefore, for reducing the overall compliance of a system, it is best to increase the dimension of our shaft 4. That is, to improve the stiffness of that element which contributes maximum to the overall compliance. And it is therefore we can say that shaft 4 is the weakest link in a chain, and the weakest link can be made stronger only by increasing its dimension, that is, the diameter of a shaft. Now let us consider another case. In that, you can see a diagram C. Okay, so this represents a spring in a parallel connection. Now for a parallel connection, we clearly know that the deflection will remain constant, that is, a deflection for all the three springs will be same, but the force will be distributed for each of the spring arrangement. Okay, so let's say that for a first spring, the stiffness is K1. Okay, deflection is constant. Okay, but force will be how much? So let's say it is P1. For spring 2, it would be P2, and for spring 3, it would be P3. But the deflection will remain same in all the three springs. Why? Because all the three are in a parallel connection. Now, as you can see, it is written that Y is equal to Y1 equals to Y2 is equal to Y3. Now, the total force will be equal to summation of all the three forces, right, that is exerted on a different springs. So, P will be equal to P1 plus P2 plus P3. Now, since we know our formula of a stiffness, that is K, stiffness K is equal to P upon displacement, that is, load upon displacement. So from that, we can say that P can be a subject, can be made as a subject, and can be written as KY equals to K1Y plus K2Y plus K3Y. So from this equation, we can say that Y will get cancelled out from both the sides, and a final equation of a stiffness will become K is equal to K1 plus K2 plus K3. So So this, in this equation, we can say the total stiffness is a summation of stiffness of individual spring, whereas in a previous case of a series connection, the total stiffness basically is a reciprocal of the summation of stiffnesses, right, of each spring. And in that case, we were determining the compliance. Okay, now in order to understand this parallel connection arrangement, I'm going to take one example. So remember, this equation of a stiffness is represented by equation number 3.14. So the important corollary that ensues from equation 3.11 is that system of a spring joined in parallel, the overall stiffness can be improved best by strengthening the strongest element of a chain. Now let us elaborate the point by taking an example. So suppose in a system of a two spring, one spring is going to contribute only 90%, whereas the other spring going to contribute 10% of the total stiffness. Okay, so we can say that there are two springs. One of the spring is contributing 90% of a stiffness, another is contributing only 10%. So if a stiffness of a weaker member is increased two times, for example, if a stiffness of a weaker member is increased two times, so it will increase the overall stiffness in the ratio 110:100. Now how it is coming? So we can say that weaker link or weaker spring has how much stiffness? So 10%. Now if it is increased by two times, which means 20%. Okay, so total stiffness would be provided to this weaker would be 20%. Now this 20% plus 90 will contribute how much? So it would be 110, right? Whereas if the stiffness of a stronger member is increased two times, so the stronger member is contributing how much? So it is contributing 90%, right? So two times means 180, right? So 180%, and the weaker will contribute how much? 10%. So total would be 180 plus 10, that is 190. So we can say the overall stiffness will be increased in a ratio 190:100. So which is preferable? So obviously we need to strengthen which spring? The spring which contributes 90% of our total stiffness. Okay, so you can clearly take an example from this, that K1, K2 are weaker compared to K3, and K3 is contributing, for example, 90%. So which spring has to be strengthened to provide the support to all the three elements? So we would say the spring which having the stiffness K3 has to be strengthened. Okay guys, so in today's session, we are keeping up till here. In our next session, we will start with our aperture topic. So till then, stay tuned and thank you all.